the values that I was given by my parents and by Ethiopia, and growing up in a developing country or considered a poor country, the only way out for us, at least, whether you are a woman or a man for that matter, but especially more if you are a woman, is hard work and education. And we have done, mainly Africans strive to get educated because they hope for a better life, and you definitely have to work hard. That goes hand in hand. And that's mainly what I've been doing. And although I have not been educated to feel less as a woman, I have not been educated either to feel equal as a man. I had to fill between the gaps and rise above. Everyone has their own techniques to kind of navigate within these hurdles, but assertivity and hard work have been my motto. Everyone should have their own motto, especially today, where you have so many vocal activists to advise you or this or that. I think asserting yourself and finding your place within the society is more increasingly important in our days. And I think mentors and inspiring and motivating people should always encourage the youngsters, women and children to find their voices and find their calling in life. This is basically what I came to share with you. And I would love to hear if you have any comments or any questions. I'm here to answer them.
Wonderful. Thank you. We're going to get back to you.
I don't know if I'm missing anything, Dan, you know.
No, thank you for your just initial observations. We're certainly going to come back with questions from all of our participants. I'm going to turn to our dear friend and Rakefet Binyamini, who, you and I have known each other for some 40 years. And I know that Skeets Friedkin is on the call, and I think we were on her bus when we were going throughout the United States together doing exhibitions and trying to share this wonderful Israel Tennis and Education Center philosophy and dream, which I'm so proud and honored to see you as the embodiment of that dream come true. Because here you are, one of the senior managers and really visionaries of the tennis center today, having grown up and been number one in Israel, played Federation Cup. You're an Israeli success story, but you're also an Israeli tennis and education success story. So share with us some of your own personal obstacles and opportunities in your own experience, Rakefet.
My name is Rakefet. I'm a single mother to a boy who's 26 and a daughter who's 23, that she's an officer in the combat unit. I'm a single mother. I was first introduced to the tennis center in 1976. I will not tell you my age, like Messeret, I've been there since the first day the tennis center had been opened up. I fell in love with the game, start practicing every day, and got to be number one in Israel. Later on, I got to the army as an outstanding athlete, and got a full scholarship to university, to San Diego University in the United States, got my bachelor degree, then my master's degree, and then came back to Israel. I was working for 11 years in a private club, was doing a nice living, and then I felt a kind of emptiness in my heart, and I said I want to make a change and do something, and I read in the paper that there is an opening to be a manager in the tennis center, and I said I am applying, and I applied. And I got to be a manager of the Jaffa Tennis Center. And I'm sure some of you audience have been in Israel and been in Jaffa. Jaffa is in the south of Tel Aviv, and it's a crowded area where Arabs, Russians, Ethiopians, Sabra Israelis all live together under the same umbrella. And because I came from competitive tennis, I thought to myself, here, I'm going to do the next champion of Israel. But then when I realized the situation in this city, the poverty, the challenges, the unemployment of women, the alcoholism that around me, I said, I want to make a change and I want to bring as many children as possible to the tennis center, children at risk, Arabs and Jews, and to bring them under the same umbrella. One of the programs that I opened there, and I'm so happy to see here Ellen Goldner, is the Ethiopian program. I saw Ellen 3.5 years ago, and he came to my center in Jaffa, and he told me, Kefet, I want you to open an Ethiopian program. And I said, listen, Ellen, I am willing to open anything, but not the Ethiopians. I'm sorry. I gave them a chance. They ruined my trust, and I kind of lost. I can't do it. I just can't do it. I can do anything you want, but I don't give me the mission to open an Ethiopian program because I'm hurt. They you know, I gave them so much, and then I kind of got a punch in my face. But he was stubborn enough to say, no, this is what I want you to open up. And I did, it was very, very difficult at first. And we couldn't bring children to the tennis. They didn't know anything about tennis. All they were interested in was in soccer. And they didn't have trust in us. It was also probably my reflection. But step by step, we were going to the streets, waiting for the children that are coming to school, that are doing nothing, and bringing them to the tennis, starting with soccer, playing with them a little bit, and then gaining them trust. And today I'm this is one of my proudest programs that I have, that we have 45 Ethiopian children in our center that come on daily basis. I mean, this program is only twice a week, but they are just coming every single day. They feel that this is their home. I feel that they are my children, and it's something that's so warming my heart. Another program that I have is that the Women's Empowerment Program that I will tell you later on a little bit more about it, but it's also something that burned in my stomach, that I felt I want to make a change. I want to do something different. And the reason I wanted to open a Girls Empowerment Program is because of the life I had to go through. And when I grew up and I was an athlete, I heard from my coach sentences like, you guys can have a girlfriend, but you girls cannot have a boyfriend because it will hurt your tennis. Later on, when I played in the finals, the boys got the center court and the girls got the side court. I thought this is how it should be. We are less, we should, and I thought this is how life. And then when my daughter, I got to a point where my daughter, one more, I'm finishing soon, Dan. When my daughter was 18 and she went to the school, she came with shorts that didn't cover her knees. And the guards sent her to the principal and told her, you cannot enter the school. When she told the principal that she wanted to take the test, she has an exam today, the principal told her, you have to go back home. Your shorts do not cover your knees. And when my daughter told them, but the boy next to me come with shorts even shorter, she was sent, was not able to take the exam. And then she puts a post on Facebook that got viral, and it was a big issue. I want to tell you that all those things that happened in my life, and I just told you a few of them, have made me really stand for minorities, for women, for any group that needs help, that we can embrace them and educate them and open their mind.
Thank you very much, Rakefet, for your observations. And well, I just want to ask each one of you the same question is, you know, Israel is a curious society, because on the one hand, as President Ruvi Rivlin has said, for all the years that he's been president, you know, we are really a country of tribes, clans, families, small, tightly knit communities, you know, Ashkenazi, Sephardi, Ethiopian, and Druze, and Circassians, and religious, and non-religious, everybody is in his own. tribe, clan, and family in our little country. But at the same time, what is your sense about that, the fact that we are a tightly knit community by community, does that enable women to become, pave the way for them to become empowered, or does it somehow hold them back, this mixture of Western and Middle Eastern cultures here in Israel? Messeret, what is your sense of it?
I think it's a good thing, actually. I think Israel is very, very unique in that sense that so many communities live. This is really, I'm shocked when I think about how Israel is diverse in its society. There are so many different kinds of people, and what unites them is their vision, is their country, or their religion, or their way of life, and they're united in that. I think it's there are more liberated or emancipated societies, and there are less liberated societies, like the Ethiopian society is extremely conservative society, and I'm sure there is an overlapping of values, and also an exposure of the values of let's say the Swedish community should be, I'm assuming, and from what I've read, the Swedish society is highly focused on the women, on the emancipation of women, or assist women to fulfill themselves. So the exposure, just for people to actually see these things happen. And there is actually a cohesive family, not that the woman is going to be big-headed because she has a job, but she's actually contributing to the overall aspect of the family, whether be it bringing food to the table, or also helping the children to study better. Whereas in Ethiopia, the two roles are very defined. So actually, they get a firsthand view of that being or on the stage. So I think I only see the good side of it. Maybe, I don't know. I don't see any good, bad sides to it. I think it's a very good one. I don't know what Rakefet has to say about that.
Rakefet, what do you have to say about that? What in your view are the challenges and opportunities in Israel for women to express their leadership and their excellence and lead the society?
Well, I think that Israel is known for being a modern country and very good in high tech, but I still that in women's rights, and I still think that they need to do a long way, because there is still a gap between how the society I want her to behave and the reality. And I face it all the time. People do not do things to harm, but they do it unintentionally. I must tell you that even in our organization that is very liberal and democrat, and we give everybody and each group a chance, and we are a house, a family to everybody. We got a questionnaire, and the manager got a questionnaire that it was in a mail. The sentences were phrases in male thing, and the secretaries in female. Now nobody wanted to harm anybody, but what it means that all secretaries are women and all managers are men. It was not on purpose. And when I said, listen, you have to change the phrase of the sentences, because one of my male secretaries do not want to answer this questionnaire, they said, oh, we are sorry. So, and it's happened, I see it all over, that still a woman has, especially athletes where I come from, has to talk a certain way, look a certain way, dress a certain way, and if she doesn't fit this stereotype that the society is expecting from her, she is look like a masculine, she's look like vulgar, she looks like aggressive, and I think there is a need to be changed. And that's why I brought up the Girls Empowerment Program, where I let the girls talk about different issues that they go through, that there's some issues of inequality, of things that they see at home. A lot of the girls that I work with come from very traditional homes, that the woman stays at home, she cleans, she does the dishes. And when we brought them to our sessions with the gender specialist, we told them, you know, you can have options in life. You can go and get education, you can go to the army, you can go and have a career. And it was something that, you know, to a lot of them, it's like we opened their mind. We said, listen, if you want to be a housekeeper, that's okay. But it's up to you to decide how you want to life to be, you, to be what is the way that you want to choose. And I think what I like so much about the tennis center, that we are talking about sports, but really we are talking about education and giving these girls and boys and children at risk tools for life that they can use later on.
Thank you, Rakefet. Thank you very much for that. It seems, you know, as we're speaking, that I was checking the Knesset that was just sworn in a couple of weeks ago has 25%. There are 30 women in the Knesset, which is fairly stable over the last five Knessets. And there was a 40% increase in 2009 to where we are today. So it seems on a percentage basis that Israel seems to be doing a bit better and tracking most of Western Europe, which is about 25 to 30% women in the parliament. So at least it seems to be in the middle of the Western, of the graph of the Western, of the Western states. Israel's next foreign minister in the next rotation will be a woman. Minister Mary Regev is slated to be the next foreign minister of Israel in another 18 months. So there looks like at the top of the pyramid, certainly in the legislative branch of our government, there is some pretty satisfactory, it can always be better. But my question to you is, what are the necessary inputs that Israel needs to perhaps improve in order to perhaps help us have a prime minister who shall be a woman, and we have many leaders in industry, leaders of our banks are also women, but what tools and inputs should Israel focus on in order to help this pathway along, or Kefet, as you've just helped us understand the needs?
First, I want to say that our responsibility, you know, to do things, but I want to tell you also, Dan, that I agree that there is more women in the Knesset, but you have to understand that still the women are discriminated. For every dollar that a man makes, a woman makes 65 cents in the same position. And I think that a woman to send her CV for a senior job or for a management position, she with herself has to know that she is 100% know this job. And if she is not 100% know that she can take this position, she will not even apply and she will not even send CVs. While, you know, I don't want to attack anybody and I don't want to press anybody's, but a man can go with, it's okay, I can send my CV, I will make it, doesn't matter if I'm qualified or not, but I will make it. And that's why, you know, you can see in higher positions, less and less women first applying, and if you are applying less, of course you are hired less. But I want to mention also that through this coronavirus, we had to go through tremendous difficulties, not only that there were researchers that shows that in the unemployment rate of women were higher than men. They were the first one to be released on unpaid vacation from work. They were the last one to return to work. And also the ones that stayed got many, many tasks. And when we stayed at home, we had to take on ourselves not only the work, but also distance learning and cleaning and cooking and everything. And while, you know, the man next to us, usually it was the woman that had to do, to deal with the distance learning. And the man, when he had to deal with the distance learning, he couldn't work anymore. It was either working or learning, but the combination was very difficult. And I think it's very challenging. So, you know, there are some things that up to us that we can make a change, but there are some things that, you know, as a woman rights are growing, you know, it's still, we have to educate the society that there is an equality also in raising the children, also in taking part in the home, you know, all the requirements that we have to do at home. And and also, you know, even in our tennis center, there is only 2 female managers and out of 12 men managers. And, you know, it's difficult, but we are there. We want to educate the young generation so they can go to a leadership positions.
And very much so. Ms. Sarah, let's talk about what Rakefet's talked about here, leadership positions. You and I have talked about some of the great challenges of the Ethiopian community in Israel because of cultural differences and all kinds of factors. What do you see, having come to Israel 10 years ago as a new immigrant, that the main challenges for Ethiopian women are in Israel today?
Like Rakefet said, they are predisposed from the get-go to think that, you know, from just, you know, a woman does not dare and go apply for a job. Just like Rakefet said, it made me also realize that even me, as educated or as world-traveled as I am, unless I'm 100% sure that I would carry the task completely, I wouldn't dare take a job. Just like a man would do. So this is a very important point that she said. It's like we need. It's been said many times, the emancipation of women. Women need to be more assertive. All of those things, especially coming from an African country where just in the Corona time. Over 100 girls were raped because they were out of school by family, or the female genital mutilation has been at its peak because girls, young girls, were at home. So there is an underlying current that needs to be eliminated. I don't know at what level you can, you know, if it's a verbal conversation or it's an education through school, and telling and coaxing women or young girls to be more assertive or to say no when they're being harassed, you know, just verbally say no and not take it with you and continue the suffering. Honestly, I don't know if experts should sit down and sort this out, but the work should be done at a deeper level. Women need to be more confident of themselves, not from a conscious level or from a thinking and mind level, but from a deeper level. And that, I think, that needs to be done at a larger scale, maybe by showing examples, like you said, in the ministerial positions or in leadership positions. We need to hire more women to show example physically. But I always think that education should be a little bit different. And we've discussed it, previously, even in terms of like racism and discrimination or color discrimination. I think the government itself should be very adamant and should have you know, social campaigns against that. We need to put a firm foot on it. I don't know if this is feasible, or I'm just fantasizing of things that are not really feasible in the world we live today. But the government or authorities, all kinds of authorities, be it religious authorities or educational authorities, should show a negation towards putting down women generally, which integrates that. We actually accept it, we believe it. When just Rakefet said that, it goes also for me. As old as I am, I'm 50 years old. Actually, I was 49 a couple of days ago. So at 49, I still feel, you know, I feel paralyzed, and I don't dare. It's a question of not daring also. So we need to bring those girls to the position where they are confident from within, not just because there is a mentor that's encouraging him behind him, telling him, oh go, you can do it. But really at a higher level, I like I said, I don't know how it's done. Maybe it's a thing
I want Messeret
to think about.
Messeret, if I can interfere, I think that through the Girls Empowerment Program, what we do, we bring the girls together and only girls to a room with the gender specialist, and they can discuss different issues that they are going through. And this is the time we are talking about different things that nobody talks about. And you know, and I grew up through that program. I brought it to teenager, but through that, I was growing up because I realized many things for myself that I didn't know. And I think if we have the obligation to educate the young generation to talk about those things, I think they will have the guts, they will have the confidence, they will know that they can do anything they want to do, and they will not be afraid, and they will not be afraid of failure. And if they do a mistake, it's okay to do a mistake. And if if there are people do not accept them the way they are, it's okay also, as long as I accept myself the way I am. So we are there to support them, to help them, to embrace them. And I think that's why I like that as a manager, I can do it to them. And the more we will do it to more and more girls and also other minority groups, now we are talking about girls, then we are privileged and we are helping them, because I didn't have it when I was young. I didn't know I thought this is how life is. And so.
Why don't we show Rakefet? We have a wonderful, very, very short clip that it really graphically and illustrates some of the points that you're making here. Jackie, can we show that backgrounder?
Sure.
On Rakefet's program?
Yep. To this program, I wasn't sure what was I going to do in my future, but being here and being empowered by these girls and the sisterhood, I now know my aims, my goals, and what I want from my future.
In a few months, I'll be starting my service in the IDF as a commander of combat commanders. Honestly, I don't know if I would do that without the program. It really empowered me to go and make a change and empower other girls to do parts that and jobs that they didn't think they could do.
I think a lot about myself that I was shy before. This program has really helped me to develop my confidence because I didn't used to have it before. So, like, I came home and I realized, oh, wow, I'm so confident, you know? And I'm not shy, so it's like, it's even more, but it's even better. Because I'm awesome, so, you know, just 5, 6, 6+.
Every girl should be able to embrace who she is, to define who she wants to be,
to be confident,
to lead,
to change the world.
That's great. And I think that's it. And it's not, Rakefet, you can help us understand, that's not a, an isolated, those are not isolated girls, but that's very much the standard of what goes on in this program, as I understand it.
Yes, definitely. We started with the 20 girls, and now we, and it was like, it was a pilot, and then we expanded it to five more centers, and we have now 160 girls. Wow. That is the Girls Empowerment Program. I'm so proud, you know, and we are going to continue to grow. And I think in these times of the coronavirus, there is, I'm sorry that I'm dramatic, but it really, it's burns in my stomach. I think there is a really need for it, because we know that the domestic violence have grown up, not only in Israel, all over the world, but also in Israel. And that just 2 days ago, 35 years old, a woman from Modi'in was murdered, and a week ago from Ramat HaSharon was murdered, 23 years old. And it's not anymore a problem of the minority groups. It's not anymore a problem of people who live in the poverty or in the peripheral cities. These are cities that are very, that people do their very good living. This girl of 23 years old, Maya, was smart, was bright, went to very good high school, and her husband murdered her, and or her boyfriend, I'm not sure. And I think now it's a problem with our all society that we have to look at ourselves and understand. And the girls that come to our group, a lot of them do not have the privilege that if in Ramat HaSharon, a very nice city in Israel, a family will not work for 1 month, so it's okay, they will be able to continue. But for a single mother that comes from a she's a, for, a, how do you say, Ovdim Zarim.
Foreign workers.
Foreign workers that do not earn the one month salary, she will not have food to buy to her children. And for a family in Ramat HaSharon that have a 5 rooms apartment, that each child can be in his own room when we are staying all at home for 30, 40 days, it's not such a big problem. But for a family in a south of Tel Aviv that live in a one-bed apartment, five families, this is something that gets a lot of tension, a lot of pressure, and it risks women. The shelters for women were collapsing because of violence against them. And you know, and even when we send police to the families to protect the women, it takes the autonomy from the woman, and also it risks her more because she told the police protect her, and she is in danger again. So you can understand that in a situation, a crisis situation like this, women are more risk to poverty, more risk to violence. So we need, you know, this is the time that we have to gather together and help them more. And that's why I'm here. That's why I'm talking, because we need the help of other people to support more and more girls and to empower them. I don't like the word empower because we are not weak, but we need to change from girls empowerment to girls leaders or something like this. But we do need to give them a hand. And I think women should stand for a woman. We'll help them. And together we can make a change. And I believe that small steps can do a big change. And I'm responsible in my community, in my tennis center, and this is how we can widen up this this thing.
Yeah, I think you brought up the really important point for the tennis center, that there need to be more women managers like yourself and women executives that are leading the vision of the tennis center. One optimistic observation on my part, and I want to open it up to participants to ask questions of our two distinguished guests, and that is that the eye on our society, meaning the eye in our society, meaning the news media, is a very important part of Israeli society to achieve, Rakefet and Messeret, what you're talking about achieving, because it constantly focuses on, you know, exposing the problems, exposing the challenges. And I will say that in Israel's three main news programs, the top journalists, the anchors, are all women on all three channels. And it's, I think it's, as someone like me who comes from the world of academics and before that journalism, I'm very proud because they do actually a much better job than the men do in asking penetrating questions, in asking questions that are more holistic and regarding families and regarding implications that are broader perhaps than one has seen in the past in, you know, the traditional male anchors of news programs. And it's true also in our radio. Irit Leonor, who is an extraordinary personality, anchors the main commentary program in the morning. And another woman who is the top economic, Marciano, is the top economic anchor in the morning on the radio. And then she does TV at night. So the bottom line is that Israel has an inordinate presence of women that are setting the media agenda for Israel. I think that's something very positive that sometimes goes unnoticed or less noticed. So do we have questions from our wonderful participants? There are 33 people on the call. I'm sure that people have observations or questions for both of you. If we can, Jackie can start fielding them as our distinguished hostess or host. Are they coming in, Jackie? Should we open up? Do you want to open up or take chat questions?
As people are typing them, we have one question. Rakefet and Messeret, what do you see as the next steps for the future in creating, first of all, in strengthening and encouraging young girls and women to take a stronger role in society?
Sarah, what do you think? Oh, you're on mute again.
Mute.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah,
there you go.
I was, like I said earlier, I think Rakefet is doing a good job empowering the young girls, and I think I'm going to join her tennis center and maybe, you know, rally up with her because she's obviously a very established and a running system by which she's already helped a lot of children. But I'm just, you know, like I said, maybe you know, again, I'm not a very serious person. So I must say, maybe you need to change the setup of politics as it is so that maybe women are encouraged to come to politics. As it is, it doesn't look so attractive. It looks very aggressive, not a very honest environment. Maybe we would join if that environment was much better. And in all little communities, I'm working very hard to bring around women to be more assertive in terms of bringing up. I'm more involved in food, in the food industry and the design industry within the Ethiopian communities. There are a lot of groups of artisans that are trying to, for me, I see it as a penetration or integration within Israel. The fact that Ethiopians are showing their culture or Ethiopian women are showing their culture would inadvertently also bring them close to the community, but also empower them financially. So these are little steps that I'm doing on my own. I don't really see the big picture on how you can really change systematically the Israeli women's scene. That's why I turned the question to Rakefet.
Well, I think I think when we are in power positions and we are in a senior positions, so then we give an example, and more girls can follow up, can follow us. But I must tell you that I want to take it to sports because for a girl to be an athlete, she has to go through many obstacles and many challenges. And it's not like just like this, she's becoming, you know, a top player in Israel, you know, and it takes a while. She has to be very strong because there is some bullying. There are some, you know, laughing. I want to be optimistic in this conversation, even though I say some things that are difficult to hear, But I must tell you also from my own life that when I was in elementary school, I was the most popular girl in class. And when I went to a high school from and I was going, I was getting more and more involved in the tennis. The girls in school was starting to put makeup and heels and dresses. And I would come with my shorts and sneakers. And I felt suddenly not good with my body. I felt that I lost my confidence. I felt that I didn't want to go out of class. From being the most popular girl in class, I was staying, being at home, being in my class, didn't want to be engaged with other children because I felt something is wrong with me, something I'm not like all the rest. Nobody told me, listen, it's okay. You can be an athlete, you can wear shorts, you can be on the court and you are where I bloom and I felt so good. I felt something uncomfortable with myself. And that's why I say, I want to make it simple. I don't need to prove to anybody anything. And the girls that are in the program do not need to prove anything. Again, they should accept themselves. They should strive for the best. They should do hard work. They should try to be one next to each other. But don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to fail. Don't be afraid to make mistakes. It's okay. And I just want us to be more tolerant to ourselves, us. And Dan, you're right. There are more women in the news that commentators and they talk. And I'm very proud of this. But I don't know what this woman had to go through to be in these positions. And I'm sure they had to be very, very strong. And they got a lot of, they had I don't want to listen to this and I don't want to listen to this. They had to stand up for many things to be in these positions. So I admire them. I see them and it encourages me. But I think... And this, I hope this will continue and will grow. And what we see now, I don't want to see for every 10 men, 2.5 girls in the government. I want to see 5 and 5. This is what I want to see. I want to see this change. Then I know that we are in equal opportunities.
Rakefa, thank you. We have another question for you, asking about what are the topics that are covered within the gender empowerment sessions with the girls that when they meet on a weekly basis?
Yes, we talk on different subjects. There are subjects that we bring and then there are subjects that they bring. Now, of course, it takes time until the girls open up and they feel that it's a safe place. But when you don't critic them, you don't tell them that it's wrong or right. You just listen, you support them. They start opening up and sharing more and more things. And I want to tell you that in one of the programs, one of the girls, we asked the girls in the end of the year, can you tell us what did you achieve through this program? And one of the girls said, my confidence went up. One of the girls said, my school grades went up. And one of the girls said nothing. And we kind of closed the session. Jackie, you remember you were with me. We were start going off the court and we thought we finished. And then suddenly she says, Hey, I have something. And she said, well, what? And she said, there was a guy in my class that everybody was bullying and laughing at him. He was kind of special need. And I stood up for him and I said, stop it. The discount, did I achieve anything? And I mean, that's what I'm talking about. Those things that warms my heart, those things motivates me. Those things why I wake up in the morning and I do what I do. I do it because I want to impact, because I want to change, because I want to help. It doesn't matter how I live my life, but how I can do others' life better. And this is the purpose. This is why I open my eyes. And this is all the time I ask myself, why are you here? What are you doing? What are you doing? Because I want to help others. I want to help children. Also in the religious group, I have to say that women and also men were took this situation to up. They got computer home. They start going in the internet. They start listening what's going on in the world. And they didn't listen only to the rabbi. I mean, it's okay to listen to the rabbi. You can listen, it's okay. But know that there is a bigger epidemiology, how do you say, and there's a big something that we have to be dangerous, and you cannot go to a yeshiva and be 100 people in the same place stuck when the government and the medical say stay at home, and they suddenly opened their minds. They had their own decision. They took decisions. And that's what I want. That's what I'm looking for, you know, to help. It's not when we're talking about women empowerment, it's you know, it's taking and empowering them, but it's also empowering sections like Ethiopians and refugees and Russians and Muslims and Christians and Jews, because each one, each sector has its own problem as well as being a woman. So this is what I want to achieve. I want to help. I want Nazareth to join us and to talk and talk from her experience. And I want people to be aware of it. That's what I want, because awareness and knowledge give us power and give us the ability to change.
And you have dramatically changed the lives of the girls mm-hmm. that have gone through the program, Rakefet. One last question. Someone is asking about the age span of the girls in the program. Perhaps we should consider a boys program towards inculcating respect between the boys and the girls.
I really want to open a boys empowerment program, because I think boys need it as well as girls. I think boys should say, I'm scared, should say, I'm afraid, should say, I can cry. Can wear pink or red, or it's okay, but we have to educate them, we have to empower them, we have to tell them it's okay to show feelings, to say, you know, and it's also masculine. It's masculine to say, you apologize, and I'm sorry, and I can take the garbage and throw it outside. It's masculine. It shows that I'm, you know, it's okay, and we have to discuss it. The girls' age rate, it's between 15 and 18. And then we join them, they go to the army, and we all the time, we are involved with their life after. We are still in contact with the girls that you saw on the movie, that are now have graduated the program. One of them is going to finish the army soon. Another one is now in law school in England. So we are so proud.
So it's 12:29. Rakefet, Messeret, Dan, thank you so much. It was fantastic. And thank you all for joining us today. Our next Lunch and Learn will be on June 24th at 11:30. The topic is Overcoming Challenges in Time of Crisis. Our panelists are Noam Gershoni, former IDF pilot injured in the Lebanon War and now Israel's Paralympic wheelchair tennis champion, and Elad Roth, manager of ITEC ACO and founder of the ITEC's wheelchair tennis program for disabled children. So again, this was wonderful. Thank you all so much.
Thank you, Wendy. Thank you, Jackie. Thank you, everyone on the call, all 28 people.
Thank you.
Thank you, Alan, and Keith, and everyone else.
Hello to Dan and Rakefet and our Miss Sarah. Thank you so very much. Great job.
Thank you.
All the best.
All the best.